Namaste friends, I welcome you all for this video lecture series initiated by Bombay Chartered Accountant Societies. Friends, my name is CA Mandar Telang and I am going to deal with today the concept of blocked credit in the GST, which is a very fundamental and the soul of the GST as we understand today. Friends, GST is a value added tax, meaning thereby whenever any person is making any taxable supply, he is going to pay tax on that particular taxable supply to the extent of value addition made by that particular supply. While making this value addition, obviously that particular person is going to purchase or procure certain additional materials or services on which he would be going to pay certain taxes. The cost of that particular procurement plus his own labor and additions in that particular component would give rise to the taxable value of his output supply. To the extent of the tax which has been borne by that particular person on his input supplies is available to him as an input tax credit, and only the differential tax component, that is the difference between the tax on the output supply and the tax that he has already paid to the supplier on the input supply, would be considered as his differential tax liability which he pays to the government. This is what we consider as a concept of GST. Now, whenever a person is not in a position to get the full credit, meaning thereby whatever he has paid to his supplier, the tax incidence borne by that particular person by paying that particular amount to the supplier, if he is not in a position to get a full credit of that particular item, then to that extent, in accounting parlance, that cost, that particular tax becomes a cost to him. That means it does not become a part of your balance sheet item, but the part of your profit and loss account item. It becomes an expenditure. And whenever a particular item or the component becomes an expenditure, that gets added to the cost of the product and the tax is levied over and above that particular item. The concept of blocked credit is important for this particular purpose, that wherever there is a blocked credit, the price of the product is going to increase. Not only that, there will be taxes on taxes, resulting into the cascading effect of taxes. And therefore, it is very essential for us to know what are the areas in the GST where there are blocked credits possible. Friends, Chapter 5 of the Goods and Service Tax Act deals with the entire concept of input tax credit. There are sections from 16 to 21. Section 20, 21 are the specific sections dealing with the input service distributors. Section 19 is what we call as a section dealing with the job workers in association with section 141. So, section 19 and section 141 are dealing with the input tax provisions relating to the job workers. And the remaining sections, section 18, are so what we call it as a transitional provisions in the GST as to what would happen to the taxes, tax credits when a particular thing is happening within GST period. Section 16 is an eligible criteria. Section 17 is what we call it as a concept of blocked credit. So, most of the sections, most of the provisions of the blocked credit are contained in section 17 of the GST Act. Besides that, due to the provisions contained in the place of supply provisions in the input in the IGST Act, also there is a blocked credit possible. Say, for example, there are certain provisions in the IGST Act dealing with the place of supply of service, where the credit or the taxes are actually belonging or borne in a particular state in which that particular program is happening. Say, for example, accommodation service. In that particular state, if the accommodation service, if the person is in, say, Karnataka, and if the supplier is in Karnataka and hotel is also in Karnataka, then CGST, SGST of Karnataka would be applicable, no matter from where the person receiving the service is located. So, that particular tax becomes a blocked credit for a person who is otherwise registered in Maharashtra, because he does not have a registration in Karnataka. So, like that, there are certain provisions in the place of supply rules also, or place of supply provisions also, which are dealing with the blocked credit. Coming straight away to the provisions of section 17, I may say that there are certain, there are basically three broad aspects of this particular blocked credit. One is that whatever is relating to a business is allowable to you as a credit, and whatever is not relating to business is not allowable to you as a credit. How to apportion between a business portion and non-business portion, for that there are certain rules which are contained in the GST rules, how to apportion between them. There are another type of blocked credit concept, that is something which is related to taxable supply is only available to you as a credit, and something which is relating to an exempt supply is not available to you as a credit. So, how to determine the proportion of the credits which are available to the taxable supply and to a exempt supply, for that also there are certain rules. Zero rated supplies are considered as akin to the taxable supply. Zero rated supply basically includes exports and the supplies made to an SEZ unit. So, there is no reversal of the credit required in case of these cases. So, they are not regarded as a block credit. In addition to that, when we call as an exempt supply, there are certain items which are probably not involved in the purview of the GST, for example, land and securities. So, whenever a particular person is also dealing or having a revenue from dealing in securities or from a sale of land, whatever is the credit that may be attributable to those activities, the credit reversal would be required. Now, broadly speaking, when we talk about this credit reversal, the reversal is based on a ratio which is dependent upon the turnover of an exempt supply or a turnover of a taxable supply, or as we can say, the turnover of a personal and turnover of a non-personal. That, for that there are specific rules, but when we are talking about this, for the purpose of valuation of the land, the ready reckoner rate on which the stamp duty has been paid, that is regarded as a value. Whereas, as regards the dealings in securities, 1% of the sale value is regarded as a turnover, and accordingly that particular ratio is calculated. Other than these, there are certain specific provisions for banking and financial services, whereby they have given an option that instead of following the detailed rules which are otherwise available to everybody, they can adopt a simple procedure by reversing 50% of the tax credit that is accrued to them for a particular month, and the remaining 50% would be available to them as a credit. So, that is another specific requirement or specific option which is available to the banking company, which they have to exercise at the initial or at the beginning of the financial year. There comes a list of various supplies on which the credit is absolutely not available to you. We call it as a negative list supply. So, what are those items which are generally covered in these negative list supplies? Number one is the motor vehicle. So, whenever any person is purchasing a motor vehicle, he may be having the credits or he may have paid the taxes for that particular motor vehicle, irrespective of whether that motor vehicle is purchased by him or has been taken by him on lease. Unless and until that motor vehicle is used for certain specified supplies, the credit pertaining to the purchase or acquisition of the entire motor vehicle is denied. That means, although those motor vehicles are used for the purpose of business, the entire credit part of that particular motor credit is denied. In which cases the credit is available? Only 3 or 4 cases are provided in the law. Number one is whenever a person acquiring the motor vehicle is using it for the purpose of further supply of that motor vehicle to recipients, in that case the credit would be allowed. When that particular motor vehicle is used by him for the purpose of transportation of passenger, in that particular case the credit would be allowed. Or if that particular motor vehicle is used by him for the purpose of imparting any training relating to that particular motor vehicle or conveyance, in that particular case that credit is allowed. When it comes to the goods, the transportation of goods is also one of the permissible use against which the credit in respect of the motor vehicle is allowed. So, these are the only cases where the credit in respect of motor vehicle is allowed. In all other cases, the credit in respect of motor vehicle is not allowed. There is also another item on which the credit per se is absolutely denied. That is the foods and beverages, the expenditures on foods and beverages that the business houses are making. Now, that food and beverages can be by way of a restaurant supply, or it can be by way of a home delivery, or it can be by way of an outdoor catering. In any manner, that particular credit would not be available to you unless and until you are buying that particular food for the purpose of making a further supply against which you are going to earn some revenue on which you are going to pay taxes. Say, for example, if a particular concern is incurring or has contracted with an outdoor caterer for providing a service, outdoor caterer, he is providing him that particular service and charging him a GST on that particular supply. Now, this business house is actually collecting some nominal amounts from its employees for whatever food they are supplying to that particular employee. In that particular case, probably the credit in respect of that particular entire outdoor catering would be allowed. But if there is no remuneration or no charging or no supply that the company is making for the purpose, for their employees or for any other people who are visiting or enjoying those facilities, in that particular case, the entire credit in that particular outdoor catering element would be denied to them. Like that, supply of beauty treatment, health services are also not available to these people. That on that also the credit would not be available. Similarly, membership of clubs, health and fitness service, absolutely in the negative list, no credit would be available. In case of a rent a cab service or the life insurance or the health insurance service, the credit would be available only if they are required to be provided statutorily by the particular person under a particular statute. If there is no statutory requirement and if they are provided to, or these particular expenditure are incurred as a welfare measure, then to that extent the credit would not be allowed. The travel benefits extended to an employees on vacations such as leave travel concessions, home travel concessions, no credits would be allowed. So, in that particular case, the expenditure is incurred by the employee, he then comes with a reimbursement claim, and the company on the basis of that reimbursement claim gives certain reimbursement to him. At sometimes it is given by way of an allowance. Whatever are the bills pertaining to those travel allowance on which the company is incurring the expenditure or reimbursing the expenditure, the credits would not be allowed. Friends, another aspect which is most important and on which even the credits were not available under the earlier indirect tax regime was the provisions relating to the works contract. Works contract is a specific species of a supply where the goods and services both are involved and both are taken together by the receiver at one go. That means the labor and the material both are provided simultaneously in this type of contract. So, whenever a particular person is getting those works contract services, for the further supply of similar services, the credits would be allowed. If those services are taken in an ordinary course of business, not for the purpose of providing the similar course of services, then in that particular case, credit would not be allowed to you. Say, for example, if I am a factory, I am a factory owner or I am a company who is running a factory. In that particular factory, I want to make major reconstruction for which I avail the services of some works contractor. In that particular case, since I am not into the business of providing a further supply of works contract, I would not be allowed a credit in respect of that works contract services. Sometimes it may happen that I am taking that particular, what supplies I am taking is not in the nature of a works contract. I am procuring certain material from the market, and that particular material then I am using for the purpose of reconstruction of my factory or for these kinds of major expenditure which are going to be capitalized by books. In that case also, if whatever goods I have procured for the purpose of putting the same into use for the construction would not be allowed to me as a credit, whatever tax incidence has been incurred, that will be considered as a dead cost to me. Friends, what is more important in this particular case to know is that the construction or these works contract or these goods used for the purpose of construction of an immovable property only is not allowed to me as a credit. If it is relating to the plant and machinery, then to that extent the credits would be allowed to me. Even otherwise, what is also important to know is that whenever I am using these items for the purpose of my immovable property, unless and until I am capitalizing it in my books of accounts, As long as I am treating it as a revenue expenditure, I would be entitled to get a credit in respect of this particular thing. So, what is the blocked credit as regards the works contract? What is important for us to know is whether that particular purchases that I am making is for the purpose of acquisition of or the construction of an immovable property on my own account, or whether I am actually incurring that expenditure as a revenue expenditure or as a capital expenditure. So, these are the two important aspects which are to be considered while taking a decision as regards the block credit for works contract services. Friends, it is known to all of us that composition scheme, the persons who is rendering a service under the composition scheme is not allowed to transfer or pass on the credits. Similarly, a recipient, even if that particular composition amount is separately mentioned in the invoice, he is not allowed to take any credit of that particular composition amount by way of a credit. So, that constitutes a dead cost. So, all those composition dealers are in a way breaking the chain of the CINVAT credit or breaking the chain of the ITC credit, and therefore the government's attempt is to discourage these kinds of things, because whenever there is a breakage of in the CINVAT credit chain, the cost or the cascading effects follows. The goods and services used for personal consumption not available as a credit, and what is most important is the goods lost, stolen, destroyed or written off or disposed of by any taxable person would not be available to you as a credit. So, something which is given to you as a free sample or something against which no supply has happened because they have been destroyed or they have been written off in the books as no more usable, in all those cases there is no credit which would be available to you. Now, how and to what extent you will be required to reverse the credit, or how to identify the credit pertaining to these particular items, there are no specific rules in this regard. So, you have to apply your general accounting principles by bifurcating the expenditure or the credits pertaining to these items. But what is important over here is that there is a difference between a free sample and a quantity discount. So, to the extent a person is in a position to prove that what he has given is a discount and not a free sample, probably the reversal under the credit may not be required to him. That is a litigation prone area, but the principle is very clear that to the extent you are in a position, because the credits are available to you irrespective of whether the expenditure you had incurred is more than the revenue that you are getting. So, you may purchase a particular item for 100 rupees, you may sell it for 50 rupees, still the entire credit is available to you. There is no provision in the law denying you the credit for selling the item at a lower price than its acquisition cost. So, therefore, as long as you are in a position to prove that something is sold by you at a discounted price and without any additional consideration flowing from the recipient to you, you would be entitled to full credit even if the amount on which you have charged the tax is lesser than the amount of purchase cost on which you have taken the credit. So, these are some of the important provisions dealing with the concepts of the block credit. Considering that this is only a overview of the entire provisions dealing with the block credit, I have not touched upon the entire items in detail, but the specific provisions relating to these are given in section 17 of the CGST Act, and you are also required to see the rules relating to the input tax credit which are contained in the GST rules. Thank you.